Summer's theme.
Thank you, John. Thank you very much. Mr. Mayor, Chief, Mr. Jolliden, I want to thank you very much for the opportunity to be here tonight. And I would like to congratulate the graduates of the 1995 DARE class, and I think they need a round of applause. I'm very proud of you. I'm proud that you've taken a stand not to use alcohol or drugs or tobacco. That includes cigarettes, right? You're not going to smoke cigarettes, are you? That's right. And I really think that rather than calling tonight a graduation, what it should be called is a beginning. Because it really is the beginning of something that's very important for the rest of your life. And I'm happy to see so many moms and dads and grandpas and grandmas and aunts and uncles and friends here tonight, because DARE is a partnership. It's a partnership that includes family members, that includes cops, teachers, school administrators, and most of all, it's a partnership that includes kids. You know, the stand that you took not to use alcohol or drugs is a very important step in your life. It's a very important step to finishing school. And finishing school is probably the most important thing that you can do as a young person. And as you're getting ready to move on to junior high, it's not too early to start thinking about what you'd like to do after you finish school. Does that mean that if you make a decision in the seventh or eighth grade on something that you want to do that you can't change your mind? No, it doesn't. But it's very good to have goals in mind. It's very good to have something to work towards as young people, something to study, very hard to accomplish. You know, because when we look at the people that are in trouble in our communities and in our county, in our state today, they have a number of characteristics in common with one another. You know, right now today there's about 8,000 men and women that are either in a jail or a prison in Minnesota. Think about that. 8,000 people. How many more people than in the city of Ely? Several times. One of the characteristics that those men and women that are in jail or prison have in common is that most of them never finished school. Never finished high school. Many of them are functionally illiterate, which means they really can't read or write very well. And those aren't reasons for committing crime or getting into trouble, are they? But I think that when you really think about it, there has to be a problem associated with not finishing school and getting into trouble. And because they don't have an education, most of the people that get into trouble are also poor. We don't have a whole lot of rich criminals in Minnesota. About 95% of the people that get into trouble in our state never had a real good job. But the other characteristic that they have in common, and I think it's very important for you youngsters to think about, and the adults in the audience, is that about 65% of them have a chemical dependency problem. Again, not an excuse for the crime that they committed, but I think it's something that we should really think about and consider. Most of their chemical dependency problem is related to alcohol, because alcohol still is our number one problem drug. But the other characteristic that the men and women that are in jails and prisons today have in common is that most of them came out of abusive family situations. And one thing that they learned, it wasn't a good thing. They went on to become abusers themselves and people that don't know how to deal with conflict without violence. You know, the last 2 years in St. Louis County have been the most violent 2 years that I can recall in my short 29-year career. It's hard to believe that a guy that looks as young as me has been in law enforcement for 29 years. But that's true. In one 12-month period, a little over a year ago, we had 14 people die as a result of domestic assault, homicide, and suicides related to those homicides. Think about that, 14 people that were either murdered or took their own lives because they did not know how to deal with conflict. We had two 16-year-olds kill their moms. I can never recall two young men doing that during the same year. We had two young men taking lives of three other young men in Duluth because of a disagreement at a party. Five lives gone forever because they didn't know how to deal with conflict in an appropriate way. You've taken a stand not to use alcohol, drugs. I'd like to challenge you to something else. And when I do that, I'm not only challenging the graduates, the students here today, but also the parents and the friends that are here. Let's learn how to resolve conflict more effectively. And the place that we need to start doing that is a place where most of us learn, and that's in the home. Let's work on it. Let's make that our next goal. I feel education is the most effective way in dealing with the social problems I described as characteristics that our jail and prison populations have today. I've been, as I said, in law enforcement nearly 29 years. I spent the first 20 years as a detective locking up criminals. And we still have to have a consequence of the crime. But if we're really going to change things, we have to start making an investment on the front end of the problem. And education is the only way we can deal with employment, poverty, chemical dependency, and violence most effectively. So that's the challenge that I give to you tonight. And again, congratulations, and thank you very much for inviting me here. Because these children are the best of our future, and they are our future. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Sheriff Waller. And I just thank you for taking the time out to come up with me. Thank you, DARE Graduation. Next, I'd like to introduce a gentleman we all know. Used to be on our city government, mayor, city council. Now is our county commissioner, Mr. Mike Forsman.
I was told just to be quick, sweet, don't talk a lot there. Keep it short, and I'll do that. But I also want to take this time out, first of all, just to say thank you for going through the program to this society, the dependence on drugs, the problems that drugs have created in our schools, in our families, and in our society. The step that you kids have taken is a step that's a step in the right direction. It's a step that all of us have to commit ourselves to. As I've gotten involved in county government, the part of government that deals most with social services, the recipient of the federal and the state monies that go to help people with problems in our society, I realize how costly social services becomes. And as I've done this, I found out from many of the social workers, the sheriffs, both the undersheriff has brought it up, the Sheriff Waller have explained that many of the problems in our society come from drugs and alcohol, and they go right through our society. And with you young people taking that step towards being drug-free the rest of your life, and with each DARE program that brings you kids out and dedicates your life towards this. And your example is not only going to reflect on yourselves, but on your parents, on your peers. And that dedication is going to mean a lot towards what people call humanity, the well-being of society. And with that, we are going to enter into, I think, with a little bit of time and a lot of work. I think that this society, probably after I'm gone, is going to end up being a pretty nice society with people as dedicated as I believe you young people are. With that, I want to say thank you for going through the program. Please dedicate yourself, rededicate yourself. The things that Sheriff Waller said about the people in the jails, we just built a $14 million jail. We're not even done. We've got another about $7 million we're going to be putting onto the range for more jails. And it would be just wonderful to be a county commissioner, to be a state legislator, to be in Washington, to be the mayor, to know that we don't need as many jails. And as long as there's dedicated people like yourselves, your parents, your grandparents that are willing to set those examples, I think that time may come in the future. We sure hope so. I think all of us hope so. Thank you very much for being here. Now, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce your principal students, Mr. Bob Delbert.
Good evening. Before I begin the context of my speech, I'd like to thank the members of the graduating class of 1995 who are role models that were in our program. I remember these kids way back 13 years ago as they entered kindergarten, and not too many more days they're going to be walking across the stages as graduates, as I assume in about 6 years the graduating class of 2001 will thank you, role models, for being part of this program. It was 7 years ago that this class entered kindergarten. Specifically, it was on the date of September 4th, 1988. It's a long time ago for the students, probably not so long ago for the older folks. And in 6 years, they will be walking right across the state, starting here, walking over there, getting their diploma, and walking off as a graduating class of 2001. Over these 13 years that they will have been students in our school, the elementary school and the high school, they'll have taken part in such drug prevention programs as Project Charlie, which they did from kindergarten through fifth grade, the DARE program this year. Next year, they'll experience a program called Skills for Adolescents. In their health classes throughout their high school career, they will learn skills and be taught attitudes and learn things about how to say no, the dangers of drugs, the dangers of alcohol, the dangers of smoking. They'll have an opportunity to participate in a program called Students Against Drug and Drunk, a SAD program. And I'm sure all of their teachers now and then will be talking about the dangers of alcohol, drugs, tobacco. So we really feel in our school district that we give the students the tools to deal with how to say no, how to make smart decisions for their lives. But beyond that, I'd like to address the rest of my speech to the parents. You are a very important ingredient in your children's decisions about saying yes or no. I believe that parents have a greater influence on how their children turn out concerning drugs, alcohol, tobacco, than any program that we provide here in this school district, or any school district provides. Research shows that parents can make a greater impact on their children's use and abuse of alcohol and other drugs than their peers. Peer pressure is immense. We hear that all the time. And I believe it. I know it. I've got a couple of teenage children myself. But parents, your role modeling and setting of expectations will go farther and deeper towards the eventual kind of use your children make of alcohol and drugs. I believe that. I've got 6 points I want to make that I think you can do to make a difference in how your children use. One, tell your children that you expect them to be drug and alcohol free until it is legal for them to use. Tell them this often. Often, every chance you get. Tell them that in many different ways, not just directly, but indirectly. Tell them that in many different settings. Two, set your own family curfews and provide consequences for when your children violate them. Three, know where your kids are and who they are with, if possible, every minute of the day and night. I know that's not possible. I know that's not possible. But try to have a sense of who your children hang out with. If you don't approve of the company they're keeping, change the company or keep them at home. Four, get to know the parents of your children's friends. Make sure they have the same or higher standards and expectations as you do. Five, when and if your child makes an error in judgment and does something that violates school policy or law, help him, help her by accepting the consequences of their actions. Don't make excuses for them. It was their decision to violate. They need to accept the consequences. Lastly, number six, model appropriate behavior yourself concerning the use of alcohol. Drink in moderation if you must drink at all. Never drink and drive an automobile, boat, or recreational vehicle. Those are 6 points that I believe you can do with your children. You will go a long way towards the use and abuse they may make of drugs and alcohol. In 6 years, this class will be graduating from high school, like I've said a couple times already, the class of 2001 will be a memory to the teachers, principals, and staff of the school district. They'll be gone. It's like the class of 95 is going to be gone after June 3rd. But the members of the class of 2001 will be your children forever. Do what you can to provide them with the tools to be responsible citizens of this world. Remember, I believe that you're the key to their success. Congratulations, parents, and I mean that. You've done a good job so far. Believe me, though, the challenge lies ahead. Congratulations, class, and good luck with your future. Dare to say no. Thank you.
And now I'd like to introduce our chief of police and a friend of mine, Chief John Manning.
First of all, I'd like to thank everyone that came out this evening for this fifth annual DARE graduation for the city of Ely. My fellow parents and relatives. When John asked me to be on the stage tonight, he goes, "Would you like to make a speech?" And I said, "No, that's not my cup of tea." And so when we got up on the stage, he said, "Well, are you going to say a few words?" I said, "Well, okay, I'll say a few words." I want to thank John for the fine work he's done in the DARE program. With Gary Strombeck gone now, John's kind of taken on the whole program himself. And he's really put a lot of time in and a lot of effort. I think the DARE program is great. Results that I've seen in 5 years, I think this program is going to be even better. I want to congratulate all the kids that have been there for 17 weeks. I would hope that they have the education now and that they'll fulfill what they've learned. And I want to reiterate what Bob said. I think it's parents' responsibilities to know where their kids are, and there's nothing wrong with checking up on them. Kids will be kids and make some bad decisions sometimes, and they need some guidance to get them through the education anyway. And so again, I just want to thank everyone that showed up tonight, and congratulations again to all the graduates. Thank you.
That the boss back there, Chief Manning, he was the only one to come up to me a couple days ago and ask me, too. He said, "John, where's me? You need me help?" "Yeah," I said, "I do need some help." So he's helped me a lot with the program on tonight. Next on our agenda, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank some people that came off tonight. And I saw our mayor, Mr. Frank Salerno. Frank Salerno, told me he was going to show up pretty much tonight, and those people are very important people too, because Frank Salerno and Mike Borden were on the city council when we started there, and without their help, we wouldn't be here today. So thank you, Mr. Mayor, and Jerome Develt, and Mike. Next up, we have commitments by Mrs. Olson's class. Let me take just a minute to tell you about the commitments. This is what it boils down to. At the end of our 17 weeks, week 17, the kids come into class and they have written an essay. I tell them that this essay is their promise to you, parents, grandparents, aunts and uncles, teachers, staff, to me, that they will grow up drug-free. You are only going to hear 9 of these commitments. We had to pick out the top 3 in each class, and the class voted on it. It was very difficult. Some came very good. They were all good. But these are the top 3, and they get a little reward for number 1. They get a reward to 3. So first of all, we have Mrs. Olson's class. If I could have Alexis Garrison up. Reader commitment. Alexis.
taking a stand against drug abuse and violence. Before you take drugs or attempt an act of violence, think of the consequences. Taking drugs such as marijuana, cocaine, and angel dust can ruin the brain, lungs, and heart. They slow the reflexes, give you poor memory, and short attention spans so that you don't do well in school. Drugs can harm you, and they also get you in trouble with the law. You can get fined and also put in jail. Violence gives you a feeling of pleasure, but you hurt those people and things that you hold dear. Revenge may be sweet, but the law may not be so sweet. You also can get fined and put in jail for a long period of time. If you like hurting, if you think of hurting someone, ask a friend you know for help. The cold shoulder approach is one of the many ways you can say no to drugs, alcohol, and cigarettes. It may seem hard for you to say no under heavy peer pressure. Just stay calm and try your best. Thanks to the DARE program, we have learned a great deal about drugs and violence. The program has also showed us the effects and consequences of using drugs and violence.
Bookie book last night.